1979. He served a couple of years at the Tavares Road Prison in Tavares, Florida. And from all I can gather, a lot of what you just witnessed was recollections from Mr. Pierce and his stay at that prison. I'd like to introduce you to people that will give you some comments about what they think about the film. Miss Emily Marsh and Mr. Garen Daly. Miss Marsh was selected because she'd never seen the film, and what I want her to give us is her impression after 50 years. Does this still work? Is it still effective? Does it draw you in and not only entertain you, but give you some idea as to what it must have been like to be on the most onerous of probably prison things, and that's chain gang?
Yeah, well, I was very impressed when I watched the movie. I wasn't quite sure what to think when I first sat down and turned it on, but it really sucked me in, even though, you know, it's 50 years old and, you know, I don't have any connection to chain gang. I've never been in prison, obviously, so, but it was really suspenseful. I remember the egg scene. I had no idea what would happen, and each time he escaped, I sort of thought he'd get away this time, and then he would get caught again. So it really kept me hooked the whole time. I didn't know, you know, what to expect.
Garen, I'd be willing to bet you that you saw this 50 years ago. Is that a possibility?
Yeah, I saw it in the theater. I'm that old. So I'm really actually curious, Emily. You said that even though it's 50 years old, does that mean that films that are 50 years old are diminished?
No, I mean, that's not true, but I think that probably young people like me, and this is judgmental, you know, the special effects aren't as flashy, and, you know, we don't think of it as like, oh, wow, this is going to be, like, really amazing. It's more like, oh, this is probably a good film, and I should probably watch this, because it'll probably be good, you know.
This is actually with people who come into the industry. This film, I mean, the industry is over 110 years old now. I mean, we've got longer, and we have been telling stories on the screen for all that time, and for a generation to say, okay, well, everything before Gladiator, which is a film about a long time ago, so it's a classic, everything before that is gone. I actually have an issue with that, because the reality is that the films made in the 20s had better camera movement than some of the films that are made now. And that the editing techniques that you saw up there and the editing techniques you see in all the films that were done coming out next week were developed in the 20s and 30s. And that, you know, when you look at some of the great, great films, the storytellings, they're all the same story. We are telling the same story over and over again. It's how it applies to the generations. And the key for any great film is whether or not it still sustains itself 50 years from 75 years, 100 years, or even last week. That is what a good film does. That's what a classic film is. So to kind of discount everything because it's 50 years ago really says more about your generation.
Well, I think you're right. I think it's that I don't necessarily know about movies that are 50 years ago because
I'll tell you something that is also true. You are incredibly visually literate. You have been growing up with visual images since you were a child. You see 30 to 40,000 ads by the time you're 3 years old. Okay, so you know what a good edit is, what a bad edit is. So for me, one of the things I do like to proselytize about, and you know, obviously I'm doing it to you, and my apologies, is that you know what you know is actually much deeper than what you were able to express. And I think one of our jobs as a film place like Red River is simply to say, film goes through all generations and really is all about storytelling. And right now we're at a really crucial point in the story of film because the boundaries between what is in a theater, what is in cinema, what is on long-form TV, what is on video, what is on digital, is all blurring. So understanding what our stories are about and how we tell stories is an integral part of how we're going to make it to the next generation. And that's going to be your responsibility. So I'm just throwing it all on top of you. Okay?
Yeah.
It's
okay.
It was a deep sea. Okay. Sorry about that. I get into these things every once
good.
In a while.
Well, I can understand if I was in your place, I would probably
when you went that yeah. old.
Yeah. And I'm really glad that I sat down and watched School Handbook, which honestly, I probably wouldn't have done completely on my own. So, yeah, it was definitely worthwhile.
Well, so here's the thing. I saw it back in 1967 when I was 17 years old, and it really struck the generation, my generation. Because it was all about anti-authoritarianism, it was all about the glasses, it was all about the faux failure to communicate, it was all about rebellion and fighting against the man.
Mm-hmm.
And that really struck me back in 1967. Now, it's more like, as I look at it through the prism of you know all these years that I've done since then, it's I kept wondering whether or not Paul Newman had a post-traumatic stress syndrome. Because he did go, you know, it seemed to be that, you know, he was fighting something he wasn't able to adjust. And I think that in the prism of our current time, I'm just wondering whether that's part of it.
Oh, that's really interesting, yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
Did you introduce yourselves?
Just so we know who you are.
And,
it would be awesome.
I'm
Emily Marsh, and I'm one of the managers here.
I'm Garen Daly. I've been in the business for about 40 years. I run film festivals, and occasionally I talk on WGBH radio about film. We have a thing called Classic Cinema Challenge. What we do is exactly this. We take a film and we say, does it still hold up? So.
Do you think the film actually benefits from its simplicity? We're talking about an incredibly grim, gritty subject. I would argue that for my generation, part of the appeal is the simplicity. I would argue that we're facing existential crises with PTSD, religion. There's obviously the Christ figure in question in this film, you know, self-sacrifice and martyrdom for a cause that's very ambiguous. And the starkness and the cinematography that's present, and you're correct, it is actually more skillful with a more limited tool set than we have today. I would argue that it indeed benefits us, and that is why our generation, who's mine, are being attracted to these again. Is that stark reality? And it, in particular, Cool Handbook is dealing with his internal reality and the external reality of those glasses. So when we look at the lens, right, the lens of the glasses and the lens we're looking through, I think that painful grit is what brings people in their 20s and 30s back to seats.
I would agree with that. I think that one of the things that connected me to it was because it is so simple and it seems way more real in that way. It seems a lot more personal. It's gritty, like you said, so you kind of put yourself in Paul Newman's shoes and his questioning of, is there a God? And that's all something that we question and struggle at some point in our lives. And yeah, I think that does help because it's really a simple question and a simple, it's kind of these core questions that we have in ourselves. It doesn't need to get dolled up.
Right. And I think one of the things, just to you know, expand on that a little bit, is, you know, the film was made at a particular time. And when you look at the particular time, you have to understand what was going on in the culture at that time. So they are, you know, these films are snapshots of who we are and what we are. A lot of what was being said in that film were the questions that we were asking ourselves. It was 1967. We had just come out of the 50s. We were just talking about revolution was in the year. And the next year was 1968. And, you know, 1968 was a watershed year. You know, we were in Vietnam, there was assassinations, the questions about what religion was, and I think all of that came into play into this film. And again, what I was talking about before, what makes a good film is that it is able to transcend from its point in time and still speak to us at another time. And I think at this particular point in time, when, excuse my politics, we have a narcissistic, malignant, a bully in the, White House, not unlike we had it in the 60s, we are in existential crises. And where do we fit in this, and what is our role? And I think that is one of the questions that Cool Hand Luke was asking. What is our role in this? And do, one of the big things in this film was about feeding. You know, they were feeding off him, and literally they made that scene where they were taking the food out of his hand. They were feeding off of him, and they were using him as a leader, yet they were not leading themselves. Any questions?
I'm curious about a more contemporary film that I often, that reminds me in some ways of Cool Hand Luke, is Shawshank Redemption. It's Cool Hand Luke is one of my favorites. That also is a movie that I've always really liked. And so much of it is about the relationships among the inmates. Though you don't have a crystal ball, that was, I just checked it, that was 1994. Do you have any sense, any of you, those of you who are familiar with it, whether that would be the kind of movie that 50 years from now, 50 years from 94, would stand up in the way that I think Cool Hand Luke does?
You want to answer that?
I haven't seen that film.
So
probably another one I should watch.
Yeah, it is another one you should watch. Well, first of all, let's back off a little bit on it. This is the entire prison genre. Because
right.
There's also I Was a Fugitive from a Chain Gang. There's all those 30s films that were made by Warner Brothers, back talking about of prisons. There's a whole series of genre of prison films. One of the reasons that the genre works so well is because you're able to have a confined universe, and in that universe you have distinct categories of people, and so you can have the tension build and go up and develop. So the relationship thing that you were talking about is part of it. The other part of it is that as an audience, we like to be able to get outside and go to a theater and experience something that we really haven't done before. You know, people go to horror films to get 90 minutes of thrills and scares and be able to walk out. You know, a quick little thing, or one of my other pet things that I talk about is trailers. Everyone here is going to complain about trailers they see in the movies because you see everything in the movie. Well, there's a reason for that. The reason is that the audience is no longer challenged. They want to know what's in the movie ahead of time so they know exactly what they're getting. Same thing with these prison movies. You know exactly what you're getting. You're getting men confined in a tough situation where they don't have women, they don't have the comforts of home, they have deprivation, and it's how they work and within inside that. They are stripped of their humanity, they're stripped of their free will, and they're forced to do something. So as Tim Robbins says in Shawshank Redemption, it's either time for living or time for dying.
Right. Better get busy.
Yeah, better get busy. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit about sort of like the visual techniques, camera movements, and that sort of stuff that made this film visually so interesting and compelling?
Conrad Hall.
Yeah, Conrad Hall. Very good director, very good cinematographer. Well, the cinematography and the decisions to make how you're going to shoot a film is made by the director and the cinematographer, and then is reinforced by the editor. So there's really good editing in that film, and that's one of the reasons why the cinematography stands out. But there are a couple of things that were good. There are a lot of backtracking zoom shots out. You know, the ending of the film, we're moving the camera out, so you're going from a microcosm to a bigger thing. By the way, everything was shot in Stockton, California. It was supposed to be Floyd, was shot in Stockton. But also, they're using symbolism. Like, again, for instance, the egg-eating scene, he finishes it, he's on the table, you know, and then you do the slow coming back so that you get the sense of, you know, it allows you to think about the scene rather than letting the editing take you to another place. It allows you to actually ruminate a little bit. So that was a conscious decision. So as you're pulling back, you see him there, and you see that he's on the table, and you see he's just got like a loincloth on, and that his arms are a certain way. Oh, it reminds you of a cross. Oh my God, he's got his feet crossed the same way. He is, you know, he is a Christ figure. So that theme, that leitmotif, runs through the film, and they were doing that. They also did a lot of subjective camera work. Whenever things got a little hairy and strange and weird, do you know what subjective camera work is?
No.
All right, system. It's handheld. Okay, it's like handheld and looking through someone else's eyes. That's what subjective camera was versus objective camera, which is just looking at something. So, and there are three basic shots for looking at something. There's the medium shot, which is, you know, gives you a, fills you in and tells you a story. There's the long shot, which gives you a broad panorama and gives you a sense of place. And then there's the close-up, which gives you the sense of who that person is and what they're thinking is going on. And a good actor will tell you much just by their expression of their face. Humphrey Bogart was very good for just doing a little twitch in his thing here, and you knew that he was mad. I mean, it's that small. That's what a good film actor does. And of course, going back and forth between the different shots of coming in and going out. So if someone comes in slowly, you are slowly coming into their emotions. And if you're pulling back, you're trying to like deal with that emotion and somehow process it. So in Cool Hand Luke, we saw a lot of those coming in and going out as we were getting more emotionally involved and then getting back so that we could process it. Again, very smart, well done. And Stuart Rosenberg and Conrad all take credit. They should take full credit for that. By the way, Stuart Rosenberg did another prison film called Brubaker with Robert Redford, that which is about a reformed prison ward. So, did that answer your question?
You said that I was looking up because I was trying to figure out the order of the movies. So this was 67 and Papillon was 73.
Correct.
And Great Escape was 63, which is another prison genre that's much more the kind of ensemble cast and a different, in my opinion, a very different like feel than, whereas this and Papillon to me are more similar in feel.
I agree with you. There's two little things that popped into my head. One is the author, Don, whatever his name is, Pierce? Yes, Don Pierce, hated Newman in the role. Absolutely hated him. Too skinny, he would never survive a week on the Jank Gang. Just had nothing to go for him, so he really didn't like him. Apparently, he was not a very likable guy to begin with because he punched somebody out on at the last day of the shoot and was not even invited to the premiere. The other thing was is that the studio was insisting that Conrad Hall go back and do a a series of reshoots to make sure that they got his blue eyes, because they wanted to make sure that his eyes were there so that the audience would identify with him more, rather than just, you know, a little bit more of that distance that they were looking for originally. So I think you're right. I think that if it was someone else in that role, it would not be as much of a magnetic drawing. Paul Newman is very good at that.
As crazy as it sounds, this is a Jalem production. And Jalem is shorthand for Jack Lemmon. They went to Jack Lemmon and he got the project off the ground because of his influence, and also because of him being a film producer with this company. And it was originally pitched to Columbia Pictures, who didn't want to do the film because probably one of the biggest reasons was it had a downbeat ending. They didn't like that. Some studios are back then, and continue probably to this day, interested in what's going to make the audience happy. What's going to please them? And by and large, having the principal character die at the end is usually not one of the things that the studio wants included in their films. Telly Savalas was also a person that was mentioned either as Cool Hand Luke and or as George Kennedy's part. It amazes me sometimes when you see how projects are developed and how they finally end up, and wonder what would it have been like with other people in it. This really got a very substantial cast of male actors at the time. The majority of them were pretty much geared to appearing on TV shows, probably the best TV shows, but they were all, the supporting actors were practically all coming from television. And a lot of them went on to become incredibly famous on television. I gotta remember the correct names here. Wayne Rogers went on to be Trapper John on MASH.
Joe Don Baker.
Joe Don Baker went into being Buford Pusser as in the Walking, couple of the Walking Tall movies. Ralph Waite was John Walton on The Waltons. An odd little twist of fate. Richard Davalos, who I don't think he's got maybe just a couple of mumbled lines in this. His character's name was Blind Dick, and I don't even remember hearing that as being said, introducing him in any way. Davalos beat out Paul Newman to play James Dean's brother in East of Eden, which is an odd turnabout. You go forward a dozen years, and all of a sudden, Davalos is hardly a character in the film, and Newman's a star. The other odd thing in connection with East of Eden, the actress Jo Van Fleet, who played the mother, played Dean and Davalos' mother in East of Eden.
Okay, going back to like weird things. Originally, they wanted Betty Davis for that role.
Yes, yes, they did.
Can you imagine Betty Davis?
Yeah, she refused. You read some of the backstories here about what was thought of initially or somewhere along the line, and what actually ended up being is pretty incredible. An odd fact about the guy who plays the man with no eyes, Morgan Woodward, he originally, apparently in the script, had dialogue, but the director didn't think that Morgan Woodward's voice went with the character, so all the dialogue was scrapped. And all of a sudden, you get this mystic figure who doesn't speak, but yet seemingly has an incredible this scheme of things that the other guys almost seem negligible. He's the one that's got the force and the mysterious nature. What's going on behind those mirrored glasses?
I was thinking about that fact because you told me it before we watched the movie again today, and as I was sitting there thinking, I thought, wow, that really works so well because the other figure of power is God, who's not seen or spoken or anything, and that's another like looming presence of authority. It's just a really cool combination.
Well, I have a little bit of tribute here too.
Sure.
The Strother Martin character, Captain, what was his name, Martin?
No, it was just referred to as Captain.
Okay.
He didn't really have a name.
Anyways, so they actually developed a backstory for him. And the backstory was that he was somebody who worked himself up through the criminal justice system and had just a little bit of education, enough for him to put on airs, but he wasn't smart enough to be able to synthesize all that stuff. So he was like a low-level bureaucrat with just a little bit of knowledge. Some of the most dangerous people in the world.
Strother Martin appeared in several movies with Paul Newman, sometimes in very little bitty parts, and sometimes, as in the case here, with something that was substantial. He actually made an appearance in Paul Newman's first film for Warner Brothers called The Silver Chalice, which Newman disowned. He took a full-page ad in a trade paper just as the movie was about to be released, apologizing for being in the film. He was also in what I thought was a really dynamite Paul Newman movie called Harper, a great detective movie. And he played a mystic in that, little Strother Martin did. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, he's in that. He's in Slapshot, and he's in probably what is probably not a very good Paul Newman movie with Lee Marvin called Pocket Money. So they had a little history together. And this is not unusual in the industry to find that the actors crop up, they get along, and they find roles for their friends or people who they feel are decent supporting players.
Speaking of supporting players, another little piece of trivia. George, what's his name?
Kennedy,
thank you. It's late for me. I'm usually in bed by this time. Seriously. So anyways, George Kennedy won an Oscar for Best Supporting Actor. The studio did not get behind him. And he actually did his own campaign to get an Oscar and took out a full-page ad in Variety, paid his own money for it to get the Oscar. So it was $5,000 that he had. He ran a campaign to get that Oscar. So, I mean, it's just, that's part of what industry is all about, paying for ads to get yourself an award.
Another little odd thing about one of the more effective scenes in the film was car wash scene.
Here is
an actress, Joy Harmon, who apparently auditioned before Newman and Stuart Rosenberg, the director. She wore a bikini and didn't say a word. And apparently it was, you're hired. The strange part about the sequence is that from the perspective of the prisoners and her washing the car, they weren't shot at the same time. She was pretty much alone without any actors to play off of in distance. And Rosenberg was telling her to do certain physical movements, facial expressions, gestures, and then they shot the guys, and there was a teenage cheerleader that had a coat on. And I didn't go into any detail as to what she was doing, but that was the object that they were looking at, and I would definitely assume that it wasn't as alluring as Miss Harmon.
So when she was interviewed sometime later about the role, she goes, "I just had fun washing a car. Then I went to the movies and I saw what they did, and I was really embarrassed."
dies, and that's
she's
it.
Another inmate's mother.
And she
another inmate's mother. Okay. That's right, with the package.
The other subject population in the film also never speaks. The black.
Right.
Oppressed. Right. And it's interesting. So we have.
That's more of a function of the era. It was really difficult. I mean, and during the, and in 1967,
yeah.
There were very, very few films that had black actors in the speaking lines. You know, Stanley Kramer did some in the late 50s. Then, you know, you had, you know, some coming up in the 60s. But for the most part, the studio heads were absolutely terrified that people would not go to the theater. It was a separate market.
If it was set in 47, they would be mixed.
Right.
In the prison camps, anyway.
Well, there's a whole theory about the magic black, and that's something we can discuss at another time. But you know, white people being saved by black people is a constant theme of the film.
Bagger Vance
is a perfect example. Yeah.
And the other guy that shows up kind of prominently in a couple of moments is Harry Dean Stanton. Stanton had been around at. In 1967 for probably about 13 years and started very late in life being an actor that had his presence recorded on film. He was probably pretty close to 30 when he started. And then he was in the business for 60 years. And he just passed away here in September. In another room here, we're playing a dandy little film that is somewhat autobiographical, that's probably a stretch, but there's a lot of connections between what Lucky is like at 91 and what had happened to Stanton during the course of his life. This is a pretty good capstone for a career that encompassed 60 years and pretty close to probably a couple of hundred performances in films and on television. And he was a pretty good singer. He dabbled in that too. Harry Dean Stanton, a force to reckon with.
He also taught Paul Newman how to play the banjo, which apparently was very difficult for Paul Newman to master.
There is some, I don't know if you want to call it controversy, but some idea. How many eggs did Paul Newman actually eat? it was 50, supposedly, but they said through some pretty shrewd editing, it was just a handful that he actually consumed. And that sequence took a few days to complete. Just like the fist fight scene out in front of the where they were staying. That took, if I read right, 3 days to shoot, and it ended up being maybe about 5 minutes worth of the 2 hour and 6 minute running time. Pretty good movie, holds up very well.
Any other questions?
Anything else that we might tap into that hasn't been thought of at the moment? I can tell you, I showed it at Cinema 93 over on Loudoun Road, as I did the four movies that were playing. This was a big hit, as was Bonnie and Clyde, as was In the Heat of the Night, and if I may be capable of being want to plug what's coming up. The Graduate is going to play here in a month. It's the first Thursday in December. These four movies alone would probably give you an indication that 1967 was a pretty good year for film.
To put it into perspective, the budget was $3.2 million and it cost $15 million in its initial run. So you take 50% of that, it doubled its money very easily.
Now just when you mentioned about today's movie-going population, there may be a discrepancy between movies that are out nowadays that are popular and are popularly acclaimed and those that may win Oscars. Sometimes, you know, we have to make a point of going and seeing those films that are on the Oscar-nominated list because those would not perhaps be the movies that we would have, you know, naturally chosen to go to. And that's coming from people who are here at something like this, let alone maybe more of a general population. So
I'd like to think that you come here in order to see the movies that end up winning the Oscars because we've been extraordinarily fortunate. And it was a close call last February because we hadn't played La La Land. We played Moonlight, and that was going to throw us off our feet here. We were not going to be able to say that for 10 years we played the film that ended up being considered the best picture of the year by Academy Award standards. And it was there was a lot of elation when the mistake was corrected.
Yeah, so that's my question. From the leadership of the theater here, what is the process that you would go to select the films that you choose to show?
Right.
So you want a primer on what it's like to run an art house?
but this movie is very special for reasons that might not be consistent with the movies that I can go and see tomorrow night.
So the answer to your question is every movie theater and every art house has its own personality. And the personality is reflective of the management. So I think that's really what you're asking is what is the management like? So my viewpoint of what the Red River management is that they're engaged with exploring the entire panorama of film. And so bringing and educating and letting people see different kinds of films is part of their mission. So yes, there are the films that you are playing currently that are out there that are coming out every week. You know, whether it's going to be Battle of the Sexes or whether it's going to be The Florida Project or whether it's going to be one of these other films. At the same time, there is a hunger and a thirst that is being evidenced by your participation here, and the theater sees that and responds to that by bringing in these films to show and talk about, so that it becomes a shared experience. Breaking the wall is what I call it, where we talk about films and we share it with the audience. In the old days, we would go to a theater with a silver screen, it was very mysterious. Now we want to talk about it, now we want to engage it, and we want to engage the entire spectrum of films, like Jeff Raps's with the silence films. All these films, there are tons of great films out there, and each one, as I was saying before, tells a part of the story and gives us a snapshot of the culture that came from at that particular point in time. And whether it still transcends to now, there's always a question.